Hello, my dear friends. Today we are going to discuss American writer Sylvia Plath's life story and her literary contribution as well. At very early age, she has given us lots and lots to read, contemplate, and share with our near and dear ones. Not only that, while reading, we sympathize a lot with Sylvia Plath because she had undergone depression and she had gone to asylum as well. But apart from that, the good thing is that she was able to come out, but she could not continue her fight. Therefore, eventually she lost her battle and she died at very early age. So today we are going to learn about her in detail. So let's begin. Friends, before we start this video, let me give you one information that we have made PDF on all the writers which are for UK lectureship, KVS, NVS and all other TGT and PGT examinations. So please let us know if you require these PDFs. Okay, let's continue with Sylvia Plath's story now. Sylvia Plath was an American poet, novelist and short story writer. She was born on 27th October 1932 in Jamaica Plain, Boston, Massachusetts, United States. Her expertise is seen in the genre of confessional poetry. She is renowned for The Colossus and Other Poems and Ariel, as well as The Bell Jar, a semi-autobiographical novel published shortly before her death. Plath studied at Smith College in Massachusetts at an Newnham College in Cambridge, England. She was sent to a mental institution. After that, Miss Plath went on to study poetry at Cambridge University. So friends, here you have to keep in mind to which country she belongs, okay? Then what is her date of birth, where she was born. Not only that, what is the genre of poetry that she had expertise. Then comes what are the only novel which is written by Sylvia Plath, that is The Bell Jar. Okay, apart from that, she has written poetries a lot, but this is the only novel from Plath. Next, you have to remember that she was suffering from depression, therefore she was sent to mental asylum as well. But after that, she again came back to university and continued her study of poetry. Okay, so let's continue to the next slide. In the college, she met Ted Hughes, who was on his way to world fame as a poet. She married fellow poet Ted Hughes in 1956 and they lived together in the United States and then in England. After having two children before separating in 1962. Plath was clinically depressed for most of her adult life and was treated multiple times with electroconvulsive therapy, that is ECT. Plath killed herself at the age of 30 by striking her head in an oven in her London home on February 11, 1963. Here, we get to understand that Ted Hughes is husband of Sylvia Plath and they got married in the year 1956. They had two children as well, but because of some reason, Plath was under depression. Then after having two children, she committed suicide at the age of 30. But even though this is so sad, she has given lots and lots of writings to us, which we cherish right now as well. Let's go through famous quotes from Sylvia Plath's poetries and novels. Dying is an art like everything else. I do it exceptionally well. I do it so it feels like hell. I do it so it feels real. I guess you can say I have a call. Every woman adores a fascist. The boot in the face. The brute, brute heart of a brute like you. I took a deep breath and listened to the old bray of my heart. I am, I am, I am. Her God, Lucifer, beware, beware. Out of the ash I rise with my red hair, and I eat men like air. These are the quotations from her work, and from which poetries these are extracted, we will discuss in this video itself. Further quotes are, kiss me and you will see how important I am. Is there no way out of the mind? You do not do anymore. Black shoe in which I have lived like a foot for 30 years, poor and white, barely daring to breathe or at you. If you expect nothing from anybody, you are never disappointed. The blood jet is poetry, and there is no stopping it. To the person in the bell jar, black and stopped as a dead baby, the world itself is the bad dream. So friends, these are the quotations from the work of Sylvia Plath. We will move ahead to understand her life even more better. And that we are going to do through her work. We will read all the works in details, and then we will get to understand the mindset of Sylvia Plath as well. So here I have included best of the writings of Sylvia Plath, and at first comes The Bell Jar, which is a novel, then Ariel, the collected poems, Journals of Sylvia Plath, Medusa, Lady Lazarus, Crossing the Water, The Letters of Sylvia Plath, Winter Trees, and Letters Home. These 10 works we are going to discuss in this video today. First task is The Bell Jar. The Bell Jar is the only novel written by the American writer and poet Sylvia Plath. Originally published under the pseudonym Victoria Lucas in 1963, the novel is semi-autobiographical, with the names of places and people changed. The novel was published under Plath's name for the first time in 1967. The very novel was not published in the United States until 1971, in accordance with the wishes of both Plath's husband, Ted Hughes, and her mother. The novel was a huge success, therefore it has been translated into nearly a dozen languages. So friends, here we get to see, it is the only novel which is written by Sylvia Plath, and rest of the works are poetries. Okay, and not only that, it was written under the nickname, under the pseudonym. Pseudo means nickname, false name. Okay, false name of Victoria Lucas. This is the name of Sylvia, nickname of Sylvia Plath. Then we find it is semi-autobiographical novel. The story is real, okay, but the names and the places name are changed. So rest of the things are given, and we have read out also regarding publication. Let's move towards the another slide. Here we will discuss theme, and along with theme we are going to discuss few parts from the novel as well. Okay, the details we will discuss when we discuss the summary of the novel. Let's see what is the main theme of the work. Growth through pain and rebirth. This is the main theme of the novel The Bell Jar. The Bell Jar tells the story of a young woman's coming of age, but it does not follow the usual course of adolescent development into adulthood. Instead of undergoing a progressive education in the ways of the world, culminating in an entrance into adulthood, Esther regresses into madness. Experiences intended to be life-changing in a positive sense, instead of finding new meaning in living, Esther wants to die. She aspires simply to survive. Here, we get to see that there is a lady, okay, there's a young lady, and according to the norms of the society, that lady should grow, there should be a progress, okay, and after finding education, she should be a part of society. But society has done something to her because of which she had drooped to commit suicide. Okay, somehow she was saved, but after getting recovered from this societal tendency, what happens? She just wants to survive. There is no aspirations, there is no hopes from the society of this girl, okay, of this woman, but she just wants to live in this world. Okay, there is no desire for her, there is no high ambitions for her. It is because of some reason, and what is that, we will find out in the story. Next theme is the emptiness of conventional expectation. Esther observes a gap between the society says what society says between what society says she should experience and what she does experience, and this gap intensifies her madness. Society expects women of Esther's age and station to act cheerful, flexible and confident, and Esther feels she must repress her natural gloom, cynicism and dark humor. She thinks she cannot discuss about the dark blooded life that plagued her. She knows the world of fashion she inhabits in New York should make her feel glamorous and happy, but she finds it filled with poison, drunkenness, and violence. So here there is emptiness of conventional expectation. Conventional expectation is that a person should grow, okay, they should achieve something, they should become famous, they should be successful in life, whereas this girl, Esther, even though she gets a chance to go to city, okay, where she is associated with fashion industry, there she finds dullness, gloom, which has darkened her life. And this has happened because of accident that she had met. Okay, it is not accident from any vehicle, but something unusual had happened in her life while being in city, which has blotted her life, and this has made her plague, depressed, sick, and now she wants to die. Okay, and for that she tried as well. Eventually she survived, but that was of no use because that had already shattered her dreams and aspirations from this society, and she is not able to share her things to anyone. That is troublesome for Esther. Let's move ahead. The characters in this story are Esther Greenwood, who is the main protagonist, then Dr. Gordon, Philomena Guinea, Mrs. Greenwood, Lenny Shepard, Dr. Nolan, Mrs. Willard. These are the main characters in the story. Let's find out what is the role that these characters play. Esther Greenwood is the protagonist of the story, who becomes mentally unstable during a summer spent interning at a magazine in New York City. Tormented by both the death of her father and the feeling that she simply does not fit into the culturally acceptable role of womanhood, she attempts suicide in the hope of escape. So here I told you that something has happened to Esther that we will going that we are going to read in the story. Right now you need to understand that something wrong has happened to her, and because of which she finds herself unfit for this society. Okay, and then she tries to commit suicide because all her hopes has escaped from her mind and heart. Okay, so what is that we will read in the story? Let's move to the another character, that is Darlene. Darlene is a rebel of the times, young woman, and another intern at Ladies Day, the magazine for which Esther won an internship for the summer, and Esther's best friend at the hotel in New York where all the interns stay. So here she is another intern who stayed in the hotel with Esther, and Esther, Doreen, these girls worked for Ladies Day magazine. Okay, Ladies Day magazine, and Esther had earned internship for the same magazine. Esther finds Doreen's confident persona enticing but also troublesome, as she longs for the same level of freedom but knows such behavior is frowned upon. So here Esther wants to be confident, she wants to live a free, she admires her behavior, but there is some problem in that as well. We will read in this story. Next character is John, and he is an old acquaintance of Esther. Esther, who joins her at the asylum and eventually commits suicide. John Nolan is the next character, and John Nolan is Esther's doctor at the asylum. A beautiful and caring woman, her combination of societally praised femininity and professional ability allows her to be the first woman in Esther's life she feels she can fully connect with. Nolan administers shock therapy to Esther and does it correctly, which leads to positive results. So here we find a doctor who is closer to Esther, and Esther admires her personality. She is not only a doctor, but she represents femininity, that is female members of the society. Okay, she wants to be like her because from her she receives warmth, and she treats Esther very well, which brings positive results in her. Next we have Dr. Gordon. Dr. Gordon is the first doctor Esther encounters. She self-obsessed and patronizing. He subjects her to traumatic shock treatment that haunt her for the rest of her time in medical care. The treatment which was given by Dr. Gordon was so harsh that it has become nightmare for Esther. Next character is Mrs. Greenwood. Esther's mother loves her daughter but is constantly urging Esther to mold to society's ideals of white middle-class womanhood, from which Esther feels a complete disconnection. Here, being a mother, she was so scared that her daughter will follow the wrong path. Okay, she will be deviated from the present norms of the society. Therefore, Mrs. Greenwood used to correct her daughter now and then, which Esther hated a lot, and she did not want to accept the present way of society, and therefore she finds disconnected from this present social scenario. Next is Buddy Willard, and Buddy Willard is Esther's former boyfriend from her hometown, studying to become a doctor. Buddy wants a wife who mirrors his mother and hopes Esther will be that for him. Esther adores him throughout high school, but upon learning he is not a virgin, loses respect for him and names him a hypocrite. She struggles with ending the relationship after Buddy is diagnosed with tuberculosis. He eventually proposes to her, but Esther refuses due to the decision that she will never marry, to which Buddy responds that she is crazy. Next, we have in the novel character Mrs. Willard. Buddy Willard's mother is a dedicated homemaker who is determined to have he and Esther marry. Next, we have Mr. Willard. Muddy Willard's father and Mrs. Willard's husband is a good family friend. Next is Constantine, a simultaneous interpreter with a foreign accent, takes Esther on a date while they are both in New York. They return to his apartment and Esther contemplates giving her virginity to him, but he is not attracted to her. Then we find Irwin. Irwin is a tall but rather ugly young man who gives Esther her first sexual experience, causing her to hemorrhage. He is a very well-paid professor of mathematics. He invites Esther to have coffee, which leads to her having sex with him, and as a result leads to Esther having to go to the hospital to get help to stop the bleeding. Next is Jesse. Jesse is Esther's strict boss who is very intelligent. So her plug ugly looks didn't seem to matter. She is responsible for editing Esther's work. Next, we find Lenny Shepherd, a wealthy young man living in New York, invites Doreen and Esther for drinks while they are on their way to a party. Then in the story, we get to see Doreen and Lenny. Doreen and Lenny start dating, taking Doreen away from Esther more often. Next is Philomena Guinea, a wealthy elderly lady who was the person to donate money for Esther's college scholarship. Esther's college requires each girl who is on scholarship to write a letter to her benefactor, thanking him or her. Here, next is Philomena. Philomena invites Esther to have a meal with her. At one point, she was also in an asylum herself and pays for the upscale asylum that Esther stays in. Next is Marco, a Peruvian man and friend of Lenny Shepherd. He is set up to take Esther to a party and end up attempting to rape her. Betsy is another character, and she is a wealthy girl from the magazine. And Betty is a good girl from Kansas whom Esther strives to be more like. She serves as the opposite of Doreen, and Esther finds herself torn between the two behavioral and personality extremes. Hilda is another girl from the magazine who is generally disliked by Esther after making negative comments about the Rosenbergs. Friends, I hope all the characters are clear now. If you wish, you can rewind it and go through the characters right from the beginning, and then we can move towards summary. Okay, let's begin. Summary of The Bell Jar. In 1953, Esther Greenwood, a young woman from the suburbs of Boston, receives a summer internship at a prominent magazine in New York City. She had to work under editor Jay Lee. However, Esther was not moved by the glamorous culture and lifestyle there. She instead finds her experience to be frightening and disorienting. She appreciates the witty sarcasm and adventurousness of her friend Doreen. She has a benefactress in Philomena Guinea, a formerly successful fiction writer based on Olive Higgins Pouty. So friends, here we find Esther Greenwood. She receives a letter which says that she has been selected for summer internship for this magazine, Ladies Day magazine. Okay, and she is going to be the boss, Jaylee, right? She is very strict boss. And in the room, we find Doreen and other roommates. Doreen, she becomes a bit closer to Esther. Okay, but her behavior is so extreme. Alright, she wants extreme freedom. She wants extreme partying, etc. Alright. Here, she has a benefactress in Philomena Guinea, a formerly successful fiction writer based on Olive Higgins' poetry. So here we find Esther got a benefactress who invested money for her studies, and she was so fortunate to have her who helped her in later life as well. Let's move ahead. Esther describes in detail several serio comic incidents that occur during her internship. So here, Esther is full of sweet and bitter memories. Okay, serious and comic. Sericomic means serious and comic. Okay, so her life is full of ups and downs, and during that, it has happened. What are those? We will find out here. She was kicked out from a banquet for the girls held by the staff of Ladies Day magazine. She was kicked out, and this was very depressing situation for her. She reminisces about her friend Buddy, who was more than her best friend. Buddy once had been her boyfriend in high school, and Buddy had also decided to make Esther his wife. But when Esther knew that he is already in physical relationship with someone, she did not want to be the wife of Buddy. Okay, whereas Buddy's mother was also ready for this relationship. She also muses over Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, who are scheduled for execution. So here, not only Buddy, but she remembers Julius and Ethel Rosenberg as well, who were scheduled, okay, for execution. Then we see soon before the internship ends, she attends a country club party with Doreen, and it's set up with a man who treats her roughly and nearly rapes her. Before she breaks his nose and leaves. After that, we find the roommate of Esther, that is Doreen, who loved freedom, once had taken Esther to a party. Okay, and there when she was enjoying, Doreen was enjoying, and Esther was matched with a person, okay, a man who treated her very roughly, and nearly he raped her. Okay, the violent behavior of this man made Esther angry, and she broke the nose of this man and leaves the party. When she came back that night, after returning to the hotel, she throws all of her clothes off the roof. She is so angry at the situation of this modern society that she throws off all the clothes, and later on she had to ask for the clothes to her friend to come back to her parents' home. I hope till here it's clear, friends. We will move towards another slide now. The day after she returns to her Massachusetts home, she has been hoping for another scholarly opportunity. See friends, she was so much depressed in city because of her friends, because of her life that she was leading. It was not appropriate for her. Okay, and now and then she was meeting with a person who were trying to treat Esther just like a property. So after this incident, she returns back to her parents' home, that is Massachusetts home. And now she is hoping to get some scholarly opportunity to deviate her mind. But that did not happen. Let's see what was kept by the faith for her. Once she is back in Massachusetts, she wanted to join a writing course taught by a world-famous author. Here, after coming back to her parents' home, she wanted to join a writing course. And for this, she had given application as well. Okay, but unfortunately, her plans got shattered when her mother told her about the non-acceptance of her application. It is so bad that the girl, who was already tensed, received another blow from the hands of the faith, and she was not able to join this course because her application was rejected. Okay, she decided to spend the summer potentially writing a novel. Although she feels she lacks enough life experience to write convincingly, all of her identity has been centered upon doing well academically. So friends, here we find that a girl who was of very young age had experienced lots of ups and downs in her life, and she thinks that the content for a novel is ready in her mind, but not the language with which she is going to convince the things that she experienced. Okay, therefore she says that even if I write, I might not be able to make other people convince about the situation that she had faced. So what she did finally, she had to stick to her academics and do well in this field only. Unsure of what to make of her life. Now Esther is so much in dilemma that what to do with her life. Okay, she is waiting for opportunity and that was not arriving. She wanted to be a writer and their application was rejected. She wanted to write something, but she thinks that it is not going to be convincing. So she had become so much in dilemma what to do with her life. Once she leaves school, none of the choices presented to her appeal to her. So here numerous choices were there in front of her, but it is not appealing. Okay, it is not attractive to suit Esther. Esther becomes increasingly depressed and finds herself unable to sleep. She becomes prone to depression and she is not able to sleep. Her mother encourages or perhaps forces her to see a psychiatrist, Dr. Gordon, whom Esther mistrusts because he is attractive and seems to be showing off a picture of his charming family rather than listening to her. Mother forces Esther to go to doctor because obviously being a mother, she was so much concerned about her daughter. But daughter did not believe the doctor whom mother had suggested because she thinks this doctor was attractive and therefore he was proud of his personality. Okay, and whatever she was telling, he was not listening to him. Listening to those, okay? Listening to her words. That also irritated Esther. And she did not believe this particular doctor. Not only that, the doctor had suggested ECT. Let me read out first. He prescribes electroconvulsive therapy. And afterwards, she tells her mother that she will not go back. This doctor suggested ECT, which was very painful and very nightmarish treatment, which Esther did not like at all. So after coming back home, she said she is not going to visit this doctor. Esther's mental state worsens. She makes several half-hearted attempts to suicide, including swimming far out to sea, before making a serious attempt. In the story, we find Esther's mental state worsens because she was not able to see what is the purpose of her life. Okay, and the patriarchal society depressed her a lot because she thinks that there is no identity of women in this society, and male are free to roam around even after having physical relationship, whereas girls had to suffer because of numerous tensions. So here she became so much mentally sick, and she tried to commit suicide, but initially it was half-hearted attempts. Later on, she made it serious attempts to kill herself, and it includes swimming far away, okay, far out to the sea, then taking sleeping pills, okay, and not only that, walking, crawling into a hole in the cellar, etc. Okay, because of her numerous disappearance, sometimes newspapers used to say that she was kidnapped and she was dead as well. Okay, in a very dramatic episode, the newspaper presume her kidnapping and death, but she is discovered under her house after an indeterminate amount of time. So she had confined herself in some isolated area where nobody could reach, okay, because of this, newspapers and other agencies confirmed that she was kidnapped either or she was dead by that time. But suddenly, surprisingly, she was alive and she comes out. She survives and is sent to several different mental hospitals until her college benefactress Philomena Guinea supports her stay at an elite treatment center where she meets Dr. Nolan, a female therapist. So here, she was confirmed that she had some mental issue. Therefore, she was sent to different mental institutions, okay, hospitals. And there she happens to meet with Philomena Guinea, who supported her, and she provided utter support to Esther by giving elite treatment, good treatment, okay, good treatment at good center where Dr. Nolan was the therapist. And this proved to be a pivotal point for Esther, because after that her life had changed. Esther's mental state worsens. She makes several half-hearted attempts. Okay, this we have done. We will move towards the next slide. Along with regular psychotherapy sessions, Esther is given a huge amount of insulin to produce a reaction and again receives shock treatment with Dr. Nolan ensuring that they are properly administered. Here, the therapy for Esther started, and it was psychotherapy. Okay, psychotherapy, because she was mentally ill, psychotherapy was the first thing that Esther needed, and she was given huge amount of insulin to produce a reaction. Not only that, Dr. Nolan told her that shocks are important. ECTs are beneficial for her, and these are properly administered. Okay, it is not like Dr. Gordon, which is going to be very harsh. Okay, because of Dr. Gordon's treatment, Esther had problem, but not because of Dr. Nolan. Okay, she was able to convince her that these are properly administered. ECTs are properly administered. While there, she describes her depression as a feeling of being trapped under a bell jar, struggling for breath. Now here comes the title. Okay, here we find the relevance of the title. Just like jar had trapped, okay, she was also trapped in her life. She does not know which way to go. Okay, and she is trapped now, because she is not aware about her future's path. She is not able to decide what is she made for. Okay? So here we find relevance of the title The Bell, a Bell, the Bell Jar. Eventually, Esther describes the ECT as beneficial in that it has a sort of antidepressant effect. It lifts the metaphorical bell jar in which she had felt trapped and stifled. Now she says that because of this ECT, she is able to come out of this metaphorical bell jar where she considered herself to be trapped. Okay, now this metaphorical means symbolical. It is not real. Okay, it is just symbolical. So symbolical bell jar, she was able to lift and free herself. Okay, while there, she also becomes acquainted with John Gilling, who also used to date Buddy. Now, John Gilling was also another patient in that institution, in that mental asylum. And she once had been a girlfriend of Buddy. Okay, I hope you remember who is Buddy. Buddy is boyfriend of Esther when she was in high school. Okay, so maybe during that period only John Gilling used to date him. So that is how she knows John Gilling. Esther tells Dr. Nolan how she envies the freedom that men have, and now she, as a woman, worries about getting pregnant. Esther now has received somebody to vent out her emotion, and that is Dr. Nolan. Okay, Dr. Nolan understands that she is very much trapped in this society and she wants to be like men. Okay, she wants to be like men who is not afraid of anything. They can go anywhere they want, they do whatever they wish, whereas ladies needs caution on each and every step. So because of this fact, Esther feels suffocated and she is jealous of patriarchal society as well. Dr. Nolan refers her to a doctor who fits her for a diaphragm. Esther now feels free from her fears about the consequences of sex, free from previous pressure to get married, potentially to the wrong man. Under Dr. Nolan, Esther improves and various life-changing events such as losing her virginity and John's suicide help her to regain her sanity. The novel ends with her entering the room for an interview, which will decide whether she can leave the hospital and return to school. It is suggested near the beginning of the novel that in later years, Esther goes on to have a baby. So friends, here we get to see that Dr. Nolan, who understands each and everything, she had made contraceptive for Esther. Okay, contraceptive device for Esther, and Esther had experienced so many things in her life by now. She doesn't want to get married to a person who is not fit for her, and just because of physical relationship that she had. Okay, next we find that two important things happens out here, then that is losing of her virginity and suicide of John. Okay, John, who once had been girlfriend of Bobby, she commits suicide, and Esther was shocked to experience that. The novel finally ends, okay, showing that Esther had become a matured lady. Now she is able to decide what she wants to do with her life. Okay, and after completion of this novel, we find that Esther goes on to have a baby. This was the decision that she had taken. Okay, even though she does not get married, she wants to have a baby. This was her choice. By this, the novel ends. I hope it is clear. And friends, this tells us pain and agony of Sylvia Plath. And that is why it is semi-autobiographical novel. Because Sylvia Plath had also tried to commit suicide before her successful attempt. Because of her depression, she wanted to do this She wanted to take this step, and finally she was successful, but she left two children behind, husband behind, because of her depression. Okay, after committing suicide, this had happened. So this is semi-autobiographical novel, and here only names and places are changed of place and the people, but the main content is similar to the life story of Sylvia Plath. So here we end the novel. I hope it is clear to everyone.